eminent panel members, and dear participants in the eSAGA 2021 webinar series organized by International Simulation and Gaming Association and Sri Vaishnav Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya, Indore, India. Topic of today's webinar is Simulation Games Through Virtual Worlds in Education. And we have with us a very eminent speaker for the webinar, Dr. Ramesh Sharma from Ambedkar University, Delhi, New Delhi. Before beginning the session, first of all, I would like to request Vice Chancellor of Sri Vaishnav Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya and Conference Chairperson of eSAGA 2021, Dr. Upinder Dhar, for the welcome address. Over to you, sir.
Once again, welcome from India. Here we have afternoon, 3 o'clock. This is another webinar in this series, which we had started last year, as all of you know. And we had excellent sessions so far. And I'm sure that today, our eminent speaker, who is from the heart of India, Ambedkar University, Delhi, will be equally good and will be learning while enjoying the session. eSAGA 2021 is not very far now. Only 3 months are left. So I'm sure that all of you are ready to be in the conference and learn from each other. We have a lot to learn from each other. And I'm sure that all of you are looking for that grand event. Now, coming back to the current seminar, current webinar, so I once again welcome our Dr. Ramesh Sharma, that is today's resource person, and also all the members of eSAGA fraternity. So once again, welcome and happy learning. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. So before inviting our speaker for the session, I would like to give their brief introduction to the audience. Dr. Ramesh Sharma teaches instructional design at Ambedkar University, Delhi, India. Earlier, he has taught educational technology and learning resources at Wawasan Open University, Malaysia. He is an expert in simulation games, open and distance, and technology-mediated learning. His team has got a patent on Museo Virtual Teatro Sao João from the Federal Republic of Brazil. This simulation game was created at RPGE. He has served as a visiting professor at Universidade do Estado da Bahia, UNEB, Salvador, Bahia, Brazil. Visiting professor at University of Fiji, Commonwealth of Learning, as director of the Commonwealth Educational Media Center for Asia, New Delhi. Regional director of Indira Gandhi National Open University, India, and director of distance education at University of Guyana, South America. He has been a member of advisory group on human resources development for the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, UNCTAD, while at University of Guyana. He also collaborated with UNDP for its Enhanced Public Trust, Security and Inclusion Project. Volunteer service overseas BSO and United Nations volunteer to develop suitable educational opportunities for communities and youth. He is editing Asian Journal of Distance Learning since 2003 and has been associated with several other peer-reviewed journals, including SSCI, Scopus Journals, as reviewer, editor, and editorial advisory board member in the field of open and distance learning. So I once again welcome to Dr. Ramesh Sharma for the webinar and request him to please start the session.
Okay, thank you, Rupali ji. Namaste, everyone. And I'm grateful to Vinod ji and Professor Dhar for giving me this opportunity. And I think I can directly go now for my presentation. Okay, today we are going to examine that how the virtual world assists us in creating simulations and games for educational purpose. And there are certain experiments which we have conducted recently. I'll cover them in my presentation soon. So if we see that way, that what kind of worlds we are living in, perhaps I agree with Susan Kiss when she was saying that there are three kind of worlds: the real world in which we live, then the digital world, means the World Wide Web or the internet, or how the kind of digital world, and perhaps nowadays, since we are working from home, maybe mostly we are in the digital world more rather than the real world. And the third one is as the virtual world. Just a minute, let me shift this because I have a small Zoom interface on my screen. It covers my slide. Okay, so here then, now. When we see of these digital worlds, actually, they were made more popular when there were some the other worlds they were created, and basically due to the advancements in the field of computing. So we had these and particularly those kind of the multiplayer games, they made them so many popular. And then we saw the emergence of paraverse, they called as the mirror world, for example, the Google Earth, we can see it from there now, or the intraverse or metaverse, those kind of, the technologies which exists with us. So here we will focus on what is a virtual world. And basically this is what is created by the computing powers, the computing technologies, and the creation of 3D virtual worlds in which we as human beings, we assume the role of some avatar, and they can be realistic as we can be in real life. Nowadays, the softwares have become very, very powerful, and the imitation can be up to the actual 3D visual representation of, including those of the technologies of deep fake. It is possible now able to resemble our voice. So I can create a fake voice of Dr. Vinod and put it somewhere and make him say anything like that, which he might not be saying in real life. So those things, they are quite, the technology has become so advanced then. I will not go deep into that, but I will, I think at the end of the presentation, I would like to just give you a glimpse of one platform out of the two platforms, which I have used personally. And we have a group where we are working using them. This screen you are seeing is Second Life. And Second Life was in a way, one of the most popular platforms in which everything was happening. So it is something like, if we divide the web, we can divide the web into the three categories. The tip of the iceberg is the normal web, which we all, access on a routine daily basis. But if we go below, then we have the dark web and the deep web there. So it is something like, and everything happens there. Similarly, everything used to happen in this virtual world, the Second Life, all kind of things. They happen there. So we have regularly we have been conducting conferences. This was the virtual world MOOCs, which were held just last year somewhere around August and September using this. So we have created, and all the people we gather there and share our ideas and exchange notes. The second platform is this Virbela, which is also very interesting. The only thing I have found is that when it loads, it takes so many things into the memory. And in that case, the RAM and other things, the graphic power of the system, it needs to be good so that But basically, I think that is that goes with all the kind of high-end graphical visualizations wherever, because they are the memory crunch application softwares which are there. This is a brief the interface of Virbela application, in which we can walk around, we can go inside, we can create a room where and display, say for example, for admission purpose, for classroom teaching, or anything which we want to share, to create a parallel universe of a university, something like from there. Now, this platform, they are very good sporting the kind of simulations or games or social learning with a very sound pedagogical sport with them there. This is our group. We call it as Virtual World Education Asia, in which we have our friends from various countries. We have from Indonesia, then United States, and I am yet to post my avatar into it from there. My virtual world in second life name is RCS Darwin. This is something unique with them, the naming of that. One name, like we have a surname and a first name there. So we can choose the first part of whatever it is. The second name is generated by the software. So in my case, it is Darwin. I selected it from there. So RCS Darwin, if you go to Second Life and if you want to search me, then that can be searched from there. Like Ines Setia one, her name from Indonesia. She's the editor here. So her name is Ines Ogura and like that. So there we select. And these platforms, they are not only in the education field using, even the corporations, they have started using them. And particularly, I think the credit goes to the pandemic when the face-to-face, the physical interaction is not possible and not needed also to safeguard us from the virus. So these things. And the Laval Virtual World Conference, it became quite popular because that was the physical conference presumed to be having over 150 speakers and more than 18,000 attendees there. So that was quite a big, but they successfully conducted it using some called of these virtual worlds there. So these are some of the scenes of there, that how the people, they gathered into it and then interacted. And the software has that facility that we can activate our microphones and then we can talk. I mean, so those people who are in the vicinity of us, they can interact with each other. So it is all just, we are not physically present there, but otherwise all the interactions, they are good from there. And this is on the rise, although this figure is a little older, but over a period of time, we have seen that it is constantly increasing. It's used more and more people. They are shifting these platforms from there, including if you see the very famous hype cycle, Gartner hype cycle, the kind of technologies which we think that how they are progressing it, and then shifting it from simple kind of where the technologies is works as an innovation trigger up to that, and then once we pass through the trough of illusion, disillusion, and then it becomes a solution for enlightenment. So the technologies, they try to stabilize them over a period of time when we find that yes, it has certain useful implications for us, in which we can take the benefit of that platform for us. This all started with simple multi-user dungeons, which were text-based, up to the now currently where we find them that they are completely fully graphic, massive, and belong to different locales. So anywhere we can be, we can interact with the our colleagues into that kind, into that metaverse there. And very recently now, because blockchain, the fourth industrial revolution technologies, they are suddenly the progress into it, the development, the research, it has gone into it. And then some of the technologies, they have become just the talk of the movement. And blockchain is one of them. So these products, they have even, this is the Gods Unchained, which is based on Ethereum platform for there. So now we can see that how the things they are unfolding for ourselves. Let us see some of the examples of this virtual worlds, that how they are being used. The Second Life, we will see, I'll show you the, it's a live demo just after this presentation. But there, and the name was suggested in way. And in fact, it has two variants. One is the teen grid, and the another one is the normal for the adult population there, where they can go. Because the teen grid is to protect the child from any kind of exploitation by the online those things from there. Then another example is this Active Worlds, where they say popularly as the home of the 3D internet. You can create your free avatar. Most of the, all the platforms, they allow us to do that. Then Onlineverse, Universe, again 3D. Basically for to work as a social networking platform, the people hang out there, play together, and interact with each other, sharing their ideas, their thoughts, with the, like that. This was another interesting platform, Twinity. Basically, mostly something like dating sites there. So those people who want to look for some sort of friendship with each other, they go and meet each other, and then continue with their communications. Small World, quite popular among the kids, to create, to play games, and how with the help of it, it was created by a company in the New Zealand. So that is the example for there. Then Kaneva by the American video game company there. A short of social networking, and where we can share our media, interact with our students, show them certain experiences of the virtual world. This has been very popular, the OpenSim, Open Simulator, as the open source platform, where we can host our virtual worlds and create the examples of a metaverse there. So that the Open Simulator. Let's have a quick look over the history of that, how the things they emerged from there. Basically, it goes as early as the late, early 80s, when the MUDs, the multi-user dungeons, when the computing devices, they shifted from the monochromatic kind of things, and we have the blinkers there, and then the technology allowed us to communicate with each other. So from there, then came a major attraction was the entry of NASA also into the virtual world, and they created the space, and the NASA, it is still there, where they share all those interesting things which the NASA does into the virtual world platforms there. So the things, they were progressing quite good. And then in 1986, the term virtual reality, it was created by Yaron Ladner of VPL. And then I think one of the drastic change, the biggest change came very soon by the by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the creator of World Wide Web, which made these things to offer to the people, to the world, very easy, because now we got a wonderful medium over which the information can be shared easily. So that went into it. And then we all know the very famous movie, The Matrix. In fact, it became so successful, then So the version 1, version 2, version 3, version 4. And I believe that the team is again working with a new plot, new episode. We'll share it with whom. But that showed the power of it, that you just once insert something chip and you can become Bruce Lee, or you can just download all the material into it and you work in the virtual world there, how you perform your activities or something like that. These things, so the Linden Labs in United States, they started with this, the creation of Second Life. The first, it was the pre-alpha version. And they say it became so popular that even they had their own currency, the Linden dollars. And the SL time, the Second Lifetime there. So the people they are interacting in, talking to each other and creating from there. So that became. But it is very interesting, something like that, this platform was very, very popular. But over a period of time, it lost its shine, and maybe it went into oblivion. But of late, recently, again, the people are turning back to Second Life, and due to some improvements over the platform, and then changing the way we can communicate and create our things from there. So we have the residents there, you have your areas, you can purchase, you can buy your land, you can create your own property there. And they have their own kind of currency, the kind as the Linden dollars from it into it. Then the World of Warcraft, the very popular game, particularly as an example of MMORPG, the massive multiplayer online role-playing game. So those things, they are there. But it is basically initially when these things they were started, they somehow a focus was more on, say, either entertainment or doing some kind of business. But very soon, even we in the education field, we took note of these things. And you all may be knowing the very famous Horizon report. Now again, EduCase has taken it back, but otherwise it was being published by New Media Consortium, which is a sort of a non-profit organization in the United States, published this report for many years. Every year they try to identify six kind of technologies over three spectrums, like 1 to 2 years, 3 to 4 years, and 5 and beyond years, what kind of technologies they are going to impact higher education, school sector, or the other things. And then the technologies, the trends, the weird problems which we are facing, or something like that from there. And they have also found a lead stress that on these virtual world technologies. And particularly now, their latest edition has focused on the applications of virtual reality, mixed reality, augmented reality, those kind of applications. They are impacting higher education sector to a very, very great extent. So this is the report from there, where they are saying that the adaptive learning, AI or machine learning, learning analytics, OER, the learning design, and the extended realities, including a mix of haptic technologies or mixed reality like that, how the universities, they are shifting, adopting to them, particularly in the situation where doing something in real life with the real set of people, real set of operators is difficult to manage that from there. And then having a sort of discussing certain social issues with them. So like this is a particular virtual world education roundtable. Continuously, the community meet there, the educators from all around the world, and discuss certain issues which affect all of us in the education community using these platforms from there, because they are quite useful for social learning, for education, imparting instructions for, say, like if somebody wants to learn about the history, how it all began, or something from there. When Rupaliji was introducing me, she was mentioning about this experiment. We have a team. I'm visiting professor in the State University of Bahia in Salvador, in Brazil there. And we have a group, we created a virtual museum, Unity-based platform. And Bahia means it was a theater actually some many, many years ago, a few hundred years ago, and then it got burnt down. So physically it doesn't exist anymore now. So we created it, and this is the museum you can see, and this is available online. I can share the link with you. You can download it. And this is the how the on the top, that is the actual photograph taken at that time. And the application below which we created. For that, we got a patent also registered in our name, in the team, for creation of this application. So here we try to indicate that about the cultural aspect of that time, that how the people they were meeting, exchanging their culture, the performance, arts, and those kind of things. So it has a great pedagogical value for educational subjects. The history, etc., and something like that. This is the Natural History History Museum of Vienna in Second Life, where the students they can visit different galleries, and then the teachers they can explain to themselves. It offers very wonderful knowledge resources for the students to see. The another advantage of these kind of worlds which allow us is the immediate kind of teleporting. So now I'm here in one island, I want to go somewhere, immediately I can teleport myself along with whole of the team. We can go places to places, explore the areas which have been created by the teachers all around. Then anything is possible here. We can, the teachers they create, like this is the page for in which the students are, they are being explained about study about isotopes. And then this is my friend, Mr. Hajime Nishimura from the Japan Agency for Marine Earth Science and Technology. His presence in Second Life and on virtual worlds is very good. And he has created a lot of wonderful resources on how, with the help of simulations and games, we can teach students. Like this is here, you see the simulations for the coastal habitats. And another one is there, the study of marine. So, you know, you see, this is the whole video is available, but you explore those things, take the students from there and see those things which it doesn't exist now, but we can create them so that the students or our learners, they can actually have a feel of how that thing existed at one point of time or how the things they are still being managed with the help of them, then element. This is this National Oceanographic for in United States, where they use it as the weather services and their page to teach about the weather using Second Life platform. To make the students learn about the oceanographic studies, about the scientific topics, like if we want to learn about genetics. Here it is the University of Utah, so their page on DNA extraction. This page is University of Leicester. Here they have created a short of a virtual lab, the students there, they can work and see that how different experiments they can be conducted with the help of that. This is Virtual Genealogical Society. To discuss, to talk about our genetic, how the DNA, RNA, etc., those things, they work. Not only that, we can create certain, gaming exercises for the students in which we can ask them in creating some content on their own. So it can be any adventurous, as simple as asking them to create some sort of a book, which they can share with among themselves on any aspect, up to creating some sort of experiments either for biology or chemistry or physics or any topic on for that matter, which interests them from there. It has its value for even for literature. This is a scene from the Aureli, Our Dreams Are a Second Life, where the authors of the art, it wanders through the Second Life landscapes from there. And can see, although the story goes something like, but then how the things they you can we can project on various, taking the our reader, our user in that era and during those you know, the architecture or the situation at that particular time from there. Let us see some more examples of the educational institutions which have their presence on there for the, like this is Stanford, the page from there. University of the West of England, they also have, where the students, they have created simulations for accidental investigation, psychology, business, ethics, financial accounting, etc., and like those things. So the teachers, they have created their tutorials, they create workshops using them and ask the students to participate in certain social activities with the, as the class, as the peer activity, or with can it can be with anyone who wants to interact with them using with that. Then it is Bunny Isles for Kenya here, which is supported by an NGO, and they have various courses, musical events, artistic events, or even for commercial purposes, these things, they can be, they are being used into it. Then Indiana University, my very good friend, Professor Curtis Boone, you must have heard that, he's one of the leading experts on e-learning, Indiana University in US. There, they also have their campus on Second Life. In fact, most of the examples I found are from outside India. Perhaps in India, we need to, you know, do something about it to make our presence felt more on these platforms. The Indian experiences are very less in there. And this is Virtual University of Edinburgh for teaching research and extending the outreach programs to anyone who like that. So you just see that how you use it. Then University of Delaware in Second Life. This is NASA in Second Life, and try to simulate the world, how they think, they see it. And from here, you can see that the on the education, it is grade K-4, then K-12, higher education, informal education. And you can search for you know, the TV programs or teaching materials, everything that is offered into it. Let me share some of the successful case studies of how the platform they have been used by creating the simulation and games for the people, particularly like this case from this University of Edinburgh. And why they wanted to use that due to these challenges, that in case if how to make them learn about managing major incidents or accident investigation, or creating some sort of court-based scenarios for the last. Because we cannot, you know, cert in some condition, in real life, it is difficult there, then we can always use them. Then for learning and practicing a particular kind of a methodology to give the knowledge of a particular procedure to do something to our students, which we need to do something in the field or for practical world. In fact, I know that when distance education was started, and in India, when Indira Gandhi National Open University was started, I was director of Indira Gandhi National Open University for around 2 decades. And we always used to you know, hear this comment that how can you teach health sciences courses or those kind of courses? And we used to give the example of the best example is the United Kingdom Open University, UKOU, the first open university of the world, where the courses were created on like aeronautical engineering, all kind of things. It is just not that we do not go anywhere. The course material is created in such a way that the teacher becomes their book. And then for other things, there are alternatives made available to them. So the students, they learn to how to handle expensive equipment or work in those dangerous kind of situations from there. Then digital identity, how we can and create some sort of a safety mechanism then to make them understand from there. This is a case study of the Loyalist College in Second Life, where the virtual world simulation training for the real guards on how they can be given training to particularly for improving their critical skills and how they can react to a particular given situation using this. Tony Bates is one of the great education technology expert. He also given the examples from there that how these things they are contributing to the education. And he says that they are very successful in education because we as a student and we as a participant, we establish a relationship with the character and the situation in which that character plays. So we think that we are now the main character and reacting in a particular given situation. So we could relate it with some sort of a real life application like that. And that makes us put in a proper situation on how these things we can handle a particular challenge or in a difficult situation, we can take care. For the topic on theme on personality development, again, when the feedback was taken from the students at Loyal, they found that they were able to develop more confidence, their observational skills, particularly they found that, yes, there is an improvement in that and they are better equipped now to respond to a given situation using this training into going there or from there. Then this is another teaching with by Dr. Paul, where they found that, yes, how they can be by maintaining anonymity and through mediated environment. Here, the virtual worlds, they are of very good for the teachers and students to maintain that with us. But sometimes there are certain challenges to it also, that where it may not have that deep impact as it could be. Like when we say that the chalk and talk method, you cannot be replaced, unplanned open-ended activity, if you just want to serve something without any particular focus or target into it, and then something, it may create a different kind of challenge with us. So how the pedagogy works for these things, that we need to think of how we are creating certain associative experiences, cognitive experiences, connectivist, establishing a connection between them, and how we are creating the well-defined contexts with us, these things. That's why we say that it can offer these game-based scenarios. They can be very helpful in those cases which are quite restrictive or where we have some sort of an open-ended approach working for there. Let me share some of the recent developments into it. This is the again the creators of Second Life. Now they are shifting their base, and Second Life, when we go into it, so it is coming up with the new platform called as the High Fidelity Hi-Fi there. And they are creating such a platform where with the help of HMD, we call them as the head mounted devices to experience a new kind of virtual reality gaming experience with us. Then this is another Decentraland, where again, the users, they are taken into the virtual world. This is crypto voxels, again based on the blockchain technology, again based on Ethereum blockchain. Here we can, you know, create our, we call them as assets, and then we can interact by adopting certain avatar or having chat text or voice text with the other users who are present into it or can enter into it. Then this is a Somnium space. This is open social and persistent virtual world. Again, a Unity application where we create those virtual worlds examples for content. And the Facebook, they are coming up with this Facebook Horizon, and will mean so you can create any kind of gaming or the exercise as simple as creating a puzzle up to the multiplayer as a team sport or something. They just say that you test your imagination and you can create whatever you want to be created from there. So this is there. And then it is believed that particularly due to lockdown, now if the physical presence is not, and that's why even the concerts, they are also shifting virtual. So this is Sansar, a platform, the live events to, people gather there. And then we also, when we had our conference on Second Life, we also had those songs and dance and those kind of social interactions possible using them. This just passed the Educators in Virtual Reality, the international summit there. And now ISAGA is coming up very soon. These are the further developments. That this is the virtual reality chat, a platform. So it is planning for a virtual economy and a currency and a marketplace. So we can have our own virtual world created using there. Let me just very quickly show you the platform, that how you can see that this is a Second Life, and we need to create our ID on Second Life, then it will install an application, a small patch for it, and then we can select here our, we can create, modify means our avatar, we can select based on means a new avatar or some sort of fancy kind of thing, or those who are more adventurous, they can have these, or simple classical, like mine is a classical. And then we can change all the outfits, etc. All these things, they are there. This is after that, what we do when you land, it takes you to your home page you can create, and simply we can walk around anywhere by going into a hall. And if we see that we went to go, we simply, we can search, say for example, university. If I just type the university word, and here it will show me the results which are available. So it is showing 1,114 results on university. And we can select, say like this is Valdosta State University. And at present 803 people, they are there. So it is very simple. If you want to go there, it is a regional university in Georgia State University System. Clicking on this teleport, it will take, and it will ask, do you want to teleport? So are you sure? Yes. And we will just teleport from one place to another place, and like that. And then we can explore. So this is simply going there. But here means once we own certain space, we can create our own teaching classes, content where people can meet, gather, and can, you know, work. And movement is very easy. We can simply even fly by going there, or we can walk, see, go up or stop flying. Yeah, we can land in water. So just we need to see there. Okay, so I'm now stopping it. And thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And you have discussed various types of simulation games using virtual world for education. And it is really very interesting session for all of us. Now I request all panel members and participants to ask their questions if they have. And participants, you can write your questions in QA tab also.
I can see a question by Karthik. Why India not able to make such type of games? My answer would be perhaps lack of awareness, and particularly one. The second may be more focus on using means not, because we still believe that those things, unless the teacher, we explain them, they won't have. So the kind of, the ability or the zeal they shown by the teacher, we use them perhaps to me, those are the experiences in India. That's why it is little less represented. Whether non-computer background can work on virtual media or it requires, no, Dr. Deepika, anybody can, because it doesn't require. You just need to know that how to create your ID on this platform. And after that, you just need to know how to move around. And then there are help menu. In fact, these platforms, they have a help desk menu that once you, like, it is something like chatbot of the systems nowadays. So if you are there, then the system avatars, they can come to you and ask, how may I help you? And then you can say, or you can search. So Second Life is the big platform where so many of the educational content is available and offered. I show you the example by our friend from Japan, Dr. Hajime Nishimura. He has created a lot of exciting content for the school children, where they participate in those games and simulation exercises. They assume the role of something, and then either it is a treasure hunt, searching something, or searching the a particular kind of animal, try to see that its habitat. And if you change the habitat, what will be the impact? Like dodo is extinct now. But many people, they do not know that dodo, means the bird, existed somewhere. To tell those things, to show them how these things, they are very good. So to me, you don't need to be a computer specialist for that. If you just simply know that how you can create an ID, how you can use your browser to surf around somewhere, rest of the things, they will be easy to manage. Thank you, Aman, for checking Second Life. The another example I showed it to you is VIRBELA, Virbella, and okay, Jyotishman says that the site you have shown is free or paid. Okay, basically this is free. Free for you that means you can just go participate there in something. But if you, because now it is in a way Second Life, means as a second world. So mostly the people, they have acquired their properties, they purchase, you need to, if you want to create your own asset into it, then it is something like happening on, you use your Second Life SL dollars and you purchase, buy, and then you create your own infrastructure. Otherwise, other than that, it is free. It doesn't charge you anything for creating your own. If you want to create your own, say like university space where the thing, then definitely you need to buy a piece of land on this, because this is the world. You need to purchase something from there. As an institution, can we get license for education free of cost? Yeah, you can create your ID, and then after that, you can build your own things into it. Okay. Elsbeth says that my experience has been that takes little time to learn the basic. How do we help educators get past that time barrier when there are so many expectations on them? Yeah, I agree that means initially the challenge may come that we do not know what to see and what to find. And that's why I showed you the example that you go into, and if you just type university or what you want to see into the chat, and then it will display from there. And the good thing is there that we just need to teleport ourselves from there and then move around, we will find it. So with little practice, perhaps we can take care of that challenge. Indian gamers do not typically pay high amount for such type of games. Maybe we are more solo players rather than assuming the role of multi-location, multiple players playing with each other or creating. But I think keeping in view maybe the kind of infrastructure available and the initiative taken by the teacher, but that can be a good, you know, measure for doing it. Do you know some more example of using game for enter there is huge gaming industry for learning purposes. Games for entertainment. Yes, there are some simple games like I use. It is a simple, it is not a simulated or virtual world, but there is one very good example. It is called as I Am Puzzle. If you make a Google search, I like this website very much. It creates a puzzle, and every day, or you can use your own content, add to this website. This is free website. The people, they can play independently or as a group on a particular, and this website is very good. I have used it quite a few times with the younger students, and they like it very much. I Am Puzzle, that is there. And then let me share one more example. This is very good website for showing these kind of interactive games. Just let me retrieve the URL. I will paste it here in the chat box, and I think I can demonstrate. Okay, I it is working now. So here, so this is a website showing on food chain, and this is quite interesting games. And it has a lot of games, not only for food chain, but you can see about the world, about animals, vocabulary, health, science, mathematics, and there you can use it. So this is coming up. So here it is, food chain, and you click on it. Sometimes it may ask you to enable the Flash player. So this is show, will show the food chain. You can explore, you can see the various options available on it from there. Any other question? Will these platforms replace the traditional teaching methodology or will act as a support? No, I think, replacing the traditional teaching methodology in the near future will not be there. I remember the quote of a very famous person. I forgot the name. I'm not able to recall who said that. But I remember what was said is that technology will not replace teachers. The teachers will be, those teachers who do not use the technology will be replaced by those teachers who use the technology. So that may happen. But otherwise, mostly these things, they are our assistants, making our task easy to implement the pedagogical innovations in a much better way to take our instructions to our students. Which platform or game engine do they use for web simulators? Mostly I have seen most of the applications using Unity game engine, UNITY. It is open source platform. You can try and you can create your own tools with that. In fact, if you can make a Google search on Sao Jao da Bahia, there you can check that platform and download that application. Let me post that URL into the chat. I'm posting it into the chat section for, it is going to all panelists. So now I'm going to send it to all attendees also. This is the application which we created using Unity. So that is a good platform for dealing. Unreal Engine is also good. Yes. How do we help administrators accept that there is a new skill? Good question. Perhaps I remember of that psychological principle that you can take the horse to the pond but cannot make it drink water unless the horse is thirsty. So maybe that thing, it is something like unless you will be, this is a funny thing. Last year, I was requested by a university to conduct a webinar for them. So it was a one-day webinar and my turn was second in sequence. And before me, there was this teacher who was taking that session. It was all online session. And like today, Vinodji asked me to join a little early so that we can check my audio video goes well. So they also requested me, sir, can you come a little 5-10 minutes early? So okay. So I entered the session and that gentleman was openly saying, there is nothing like, online education is nothing unless we teach face-to-face, teaching won't happen. This not only face-to-face teaching is best, this, that. And I was thinking, oh my God, because next is my session and I have to speak on online education, e-learning, and my task is going to be difficult. And I remember that when I was giving a student was saying that, we would like. But this due to this lockdown, when we are working from home, we all have shifted to online technologies. So maybe in some cases, administrators from that point of view, if the external forces, sometimes they make us do the things if we are not doing on our own for the betterment. Ultimately, the purpose is to make the instructions delivery effective, easy, and adding to the pedagogical significance of that. That is the basic purpose of these things. Will it be feasible or can we explain the theory of finance or international business through such simulation? Yes, why not? I just showed you about those platforms, particularly those which are based on blockchain. Blockchain is all about transactions, which are opaque, which are very secure, and those things. So absolutely any means that topic can be, it is a medium actually. We need to be imaginative and creative on what we want to display. And as we already discussed, we need to develop that skill that how we will be creating those assets and then taking them further. Okay, I think, perhaps I have covered all these questions. Over to you, Rupali ji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for answering all the questions. Now, I request founder of Mentis, Dr. Vinod Dambhlekar, sir, to propose words of thanks.
Thank you, Rupal. Dr. Sharma, most of us were taught by chalk and a blackboard. We were also taught via role play, cards, and board games, etc. So when we are presented with virtual worlds and MMORPG and Second Life and so many visualizations and where you assume somebody else's avatar and all that, all of us, students and teachers and trainers, we are shocked. We are shocked not because it's difficult. We are shocked because it is new. I think the challenge is how to get people shocked slowly into understanding and using this, maybe in small paces. And I think after that, everything will be fine. I remember in 2004, or 2003, I think, we were actually holding FDPs to teach teachers how to make PowerPoint slides. And that's only about 17 years ago. 17 years ago, in today's terms, about 5 or 6 generations. So I suspect this is the year 2021. Maybe by 2025, all of us will be using this. And nobody will say it's so difficult and so dangerous. And I mean, will it replace traditional teachers? I don't think we'll have arguments like that. I think the pace of technology is huge. I mean, if you look back, we had those instruments called Decadec, I think it was called, where you couldn't take the telephone anywhere outside your house. But now we have a cell phone on which we are talking to each other, we're making presentations. We are learning. I think we need to find out how to learn in a different way. And I think these high-tech ways, I say high-tech because we were taught, my school taught me with blackboards and chalk and teachers who said, this is the subject and that is the syllabus and so on. You took us far away from the traditional methods of learning and studying. I am sure that I can probably sit through maybe an hour of simulation via Second Life and MMORPG, etc. And probably it could cover about 2 or 3 months of classroom study. And if I can do that over a period of time, I mean, initially I will not be able to absorb so much. I mean, need 4 or 5 hours of rest after every 1 hour of participation as an avatar. Imagine you're telling us about teleportation, which Scotty used to do in the Star Wars or whatever. Beam me up, Scotty. When you said teleportation, that's what I remembered. We are seeing something very fantastic. And I think the fantasy part of it, the mystery part of it is challenging us. It's so new that we say, no, we can't do this. Actually, there's no danger. The only danger is failure. I think we need time. And probably the producers of these games also need to get traditional teachers under their wing and somehow not train them, perhaps find a way of addressing their fears and embarrassment and take them further. Perhaps you could have a course, maybe a 10-hour course or 15-hour course in universities. I wish you would do something about it in some universities and say, this is a course on, like Dr. Hani Gupta spoke about earlier, can we have a course on international business or finance? Using only an MMORPG or a Second Life as an example, based on that. And I think if you can build in the fun and the excitement, a topic that Elena spoke about, I think we have it made. Initially, I think the steps that we take will be short and small. We will have failures along the way. But I think if you do that, maybe just about half a dozen universities today, next year we probably will have them in dozens. And by the time we hit 2025, we probably will have no classroom with a blackboard or a whiteboard and chalk and whatever. And I think we'll be talking happily about something and say, we probably will say, why didn't we think about this earlier? Thank you for a very fascinating presentation. You took us around the world. Brazil, Cambodia, here, there, everywhere. That remark about technology replacing teachers is very relevant. It says that teachers also must learn at a pace faster than the teachers, the students should. I think we've all had fun. I think you woke us up to the fact that there's a lot of technology changes everywhere else. Why can't it there also be amongst teachers, schools, colleges, universities, amongst trainers like us, and amongst simulators like us? I mean, forces us to wonder. And if we can have an education that makes us wonder, I think so be it. I think we need to take that. Thank you for a wonderful piece. I think I need to thank the people who asked questions also. The interactions were very fruitful. Thank you all for participation. The university and the Sri Vaishnav University is also sponsoring the ISAC conference in September. I hope all of you will be there in some form or the other, your contributions, listening, etc. Because we want simulations to be fun, entertaining, and to help us learn and understand. Dr. Sharma, thank you for being with us today. Rupali, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And thank you all of us for being with us for the webinar. I request all the participants to fill the feedback form as mentioned in the chat box for getting e-certificate. And once again, thank you all of you. Thank you, Sharma sir. And see you, all of you, for the next webinar. Till then, take care and have a nice time. Thank you.
Just Vinod sir, want to say something.
Yeah, thank you all for the ISAGA members as well. Some of them came a little late. I couldn't invite them, acknowledge them. Elena came in late. Thomas came in very quietly and sat down somewhere and was listening. Elizabeth came and Elizabeth's participation. Always Elizabeth was there to ask us tough questions about what to do next. She's always into the future. Eric came and disappeared for a while. I don't know where he is. But we can see Toshiko with her 100% attendance at all webinars. Whatever happens, there could be a